Dit zijn de Daily Minutes, haastige spoed, zelden goed, zoals misschien te horen is op de achtergrond. Het muziekje loopt al. Ik wilde per se een data-experiment doen, naar aanleiding van de uitzending van Slowscan Radio gisteren ook. Wat ik doe is dat ik SSTV heb en tegelijkertijd MFSK 32. Die MFSK 32 die wordt na 30 seconden 10 dB zwakker en na 60 seconden weer 10 dB. En vervolgens zakt hij een paar keer met 5 dB stapjes. Ik wil kijken wat de invloed is in het SSTV-beeld als ik dat via de stream zo uitzend. De uitzending vandaag is in het Engels, this bulletin will be in English. En we starten met de ARRL en daarna de column van Onno.
This is ARRL Audio News, your weekly summary of news highlights from the world of amateur radio. If you retransmit audio news through a repeater, listen for the Morse code K character, followed by 4 seconds of silence. That's your cue to stop transmitting so that your repeater timer can reset.
I'm Carla Pereira, KC1HSX, and these are our stories for Friday, March 8th. The ARRL Lifelong Learning Department has launched a revised and updated Introduction to Emergency Communications course, or EC-001, and demand to sign up is prompting the recruitment of additional course mentors to expand the schedule. Registration just opened for the first of 4 EC-001 online sessions, which will run from Monday, April 1st until Friday, May 31st. The new EC-001 course has been beta tested by course mentors and transferred into a new online learning platform. With the closing last year of the Connecticut Distance Learning Consortium, EC-001 lost its virtual home and was taken offline. At that point, the ARRL Emergency Preparedness and Lifelong Learning teams started exploring short and long-term alternatives to offer the course. After careful evaluation and review, a decision was made to move the course to a more modern learning management system called Canvas, which will be used while the new Lifelong Learning Initiative program is under development. EC-001 will eventually become a part of a comprehensive online learning environment. EC-001 is designed to provide basic knowledge and tools for emergency communications volunteers. With the online format, students can access the course at any time from anywhere during the 9-week period and may work at their own pace and on their own schedule. As in the past, students will be able to register and take the course entirely online. The Canvas platform is also mobile responsive, meaning that students can view the course materials, interact with fellow students, and complete assignments from any mobile device. Individual EC-001 sessions will serve up to 30 students, supported by an experienced mentor. Courses are free of charge. To be eligible, students must meet certain prerequisites listed on the registration page. The registration page can be found at www.arrl.org/online-course-enrollment/1. A technical paper, drafted by International Amateur Radio Union Region 1 President Don Beattie, G3BJ, is the latest official step to increase the visibility of wireless power transmission systems interference threat to amateur radio. Beattie's paper warns of a widespread and serious impact on radio communications operating in the vicinity of wireless power transmission systems if spurious emissions, measured at a distance of 10 meters, are at current CEPT Recommendation 74-01E and ITU Radio Communications Sector Recommendation SM.329-12 limits. Many of the wireless power transmission systems under development are intended for charging electric vehicles. Radio broadcasters, land mobile services, and others have also expressed concern about the spurious emissions. In addition to vehicle charging systems, Beattie's paper said further work remains regarding wireless cell phone charging, wireless power tool charging, and wireless charging of various household appliances. The sorts of rules regulating the degree of outside assistance allowed in ham radio contesting also apply in other endeavors. An Estonian skipper was recently penalized in the Golden Globe race after seeking weather routing. The apparent third-place skipper Uku Randma, ES1UKU, escaped disqualification from the round-the-world race, however, received a 72-hour penalty instead. A recording of the conversation was provided to race headquarters on February 19th. In it, Ron Ma asks, quote, I'm heading 90 degrees. Can I be sure that I can take the wind if I'm sailing east, unquote. The other station, VP8LP, advises him to move northwest and later tells Ron Ma, quote, the more north you go, the quicker you get out of the wind hole, unquote. According to a January report, some Golden Globe racers have been operating on amateur radio frequencies using phony call signs and have been asked to stop operating. One of them, second-place skipper Mark Slatz, who was reported to have been using the call sign PI3MS, said on January 15th that he was considering getting out of competitive sailing, citing safety concerns, after being banned from the ham radio net for being unlicensed. The Golden Globe 2018-2019 winner, Jean-Luc Vandenheide, who finished on January 29th, had been using the call sign J6LJV. That call sign appears under his name on QRZ.com, although authorities in St. Lucia are reported to have said they have no record of his license. The U.S. Amateur Radio on the International Space Station, or ARIS team, are about to auction a new JVC Kenwood TS-890S transceiver and a six-volume 2019 ARRL Handbook box set, both donated items made unique by bearing the signatures of U.S. astronauts. Bidding will begin on April 8th at 1200 UTC and conclude on April 14th at 2200 UTC. Next month's fundraiser auction will mark the first for ARIS. More auction details will soon be posted on the ARIS website at www.ariss.org. Winning bidders will be responsible for the cost of shipping, handling, and any required customs paperwork. The 50-member volunteer crew of the Queen Mary's W6RO Nate Brightman Wireless Room will mount a month-long special event in April to mark the 40th anniversary of the station's opening on the museum ship in Long Beach, California. A commemorative QSL card will be available with a self-addressed stamped envelope. See the W6RO listing on QRZ.com for the postal address. Founded by the late Nate Brightman, K6OSC, W6RO is the club station of the Associated Radio Amateurs of Long Beach. Brightman served as station manager for 34 years until his retirement in 2013. Brightman died in 2016 at age 99. And finally, stations around the world will once again be on air to turn the bands green as part of the St. Patrick's Day Award. The 48-hour annual event will run from 1200 UTC on March 16th until 1200 UTC on March 18th. A new award will be available to those operating modes requiring software or a computer. To register as a station or to learn more, visit the St. Patrick's Day Award website at stpatrickaward.webs.com.
And now with this week's satellite update, here's Bruce Page, KK5DO.
March 3rd was AMSAT's 50th anniversary. Yes, there have been satellites built, launched, and used for some 50 years for amateurs. It took that original small group to see a vision of satellites in the future of ham radio. Now, with the 100th satellite being granted an AMSAT Oscar number, we are well on our way to the next 50 years. Original satellites from the day were large. We're now down to what we call a 1U CubeSat. In 50 years, are we going to have what this author might call button sats? Little satellites the size of a shirt button. Never know. You can help us celebrate. We started the year with a year-long award. Operate any satellite, any mode, and collect one contact per day. When you hit 50 contacts, you can submit at the AMSAT online store for the 50th Anniversary AMSAT Satellite Friends of 50 Award. Next, we have the AMSAT Satellite Communication Achievement Award. This is the same award we currently offer, except I found 20 certificates from way back when the first AMSAT president signed them with his original call. Back then, they were printed on 20-pound goldenrod paper. These will go fast. The award started March 3rd, and we already have several that have earned one. Lastly, a bit more difficult because a lot of satellite ops aren't into HF ops, but we do still have many. This one only requires one contact with an AMSAT member on HF, any band, any mode. There are endorsements for 7, 29, 50, 92, and 200 contacts. We base the endorsements on AMSAT Oscar numbers. Of course, we don't have a Satellite 200, but we use the ISS for that. We hope you enjoy our anniversary. This is Bruce Page, KK5DO, for the ARRL Audio News.
This is the ARRL Audio News propagation forecast for Friday, March 8th. After remaining blank for more than a month, a sunspot has finally appeared. As with the previous sunspot, however, this one still represents cycle 24 activity. It does not herald the beginning of a new solar cycle, unfortunately. Thanks to the sunspot, though, the solar flux index has risen a little bit. This may result in some weak openings on bands as high as 15 meters. There is also the possibility of geomagnetic disturbances in the forecast, but they're expected to be pretty mild. On VHF and UHF, since the big winter storm system finally moved out to sea, tropospheric band openings have become kind of sparse. One possible exception, however, is extreme Southern California.
And that concludes ARRL Audio News for this week. Our thanks to all contributors to this week's report. ARRL Audio News is produced by the American Radio Relay League, the National Association for Amateur Radio. For more information on amateur radio or the ARRL, visit us on the web at arrl.org. You can also find us on Facebook and Twitter by searching for ARRL. If you have a question or comment about ARRL Audio News, email us at audionews@arrl.org. This program is copyright ARRL, all rights reserved. 73, and thanks for listening.
Foundations of Amateur Radio. I grew up with Lego, plastic blocks that you can put together in infinite variety. My oldest Lego kit hails from 1964, kit number 324, House with Garage, and it's still in pretty good nick today. It's missing the tree and the car and the garage door is broken and a few blocks have vanished, but putting it together the other day reminded me of the art of building. Today I still play with Lego. In fact, after a hiatus of several decades, I pulled out my old boxes and started sorting my blocks. That led to building the house, and while I was at it, I managed to reconstruct my first Lego Technic kit, 850, forklift, bringing with it a flood of memories. Why the Lego? It has been my source of inspiration for many decades. It has allowed me to imagine something and then go on to build it. Over the years I've learned that this is not a universal experience. I recall one friend who was gifted a huge Lego car but had no idea that you were allowed to modify it, and I blew his mind converting his four-cylinder engine into a V6. That same eye for the possibility exists in all of us. You need to look at things in a different light. One of my friends likes to shop online. He also loves to roam through the local hardware store, and I get regular photos of things that are useful. Last night I got a photo of a square washer, plate of steel, galvanized, hole in the middle with the caption, "I've got plans." I took one look at it and knew that I too had plans for that washer, which is why thoughtfully he bought a couple for me too. I didn't even need to ask. It was obvious to us both. The central hole is just the right size for an SO239, so clearly the washer is just right to act as an antenna base. You could weld it to a trailer, or drill some holes for radials, hang it from a tree, make a dipole from it. The sky is the limit, and for only 76 cents, what's not to like? I've been looking, like all my amateur friends do regularly, for a pole. I have a large 12-meter squid pole. It's very helpful to make into a vertical antenna. Use a bit of wire and you're good to go. It's a little floppy if you want to hold anything more substantial, like a horizontal dipole or an inverted V antenna. So back to the pole. I'm looking in my local hardware store for poles. Of course, I could go with the pine variety, but I'm not keen on carrying a 3.6-meter wooden pole on the roof of my car, or for that matter, several of them, so I've been looking for other solutions. Tent poles, pretty cost-effective, strong if you can guy them, and the load is vertical. There's painter's poles, which will require some testing to see if you can combine several together and make a longer contraption. The point is, I'm not seeing a painter's pole or a tent pole when I'm looking. I'm seeing the ability to hold something up. in the same way as when Calvin gets his hands on a large box and converts it into a transmogrifier, I wander the aisles of various shopping outlets looking for the possibilities that something might have, rather than the label written on the outside. Doing this is second nature, and achieving it is a matter of practice. The best advice I can give is to walk around with "what if" emblazoned on your brain. What if I could use this as an antenna? What if I could use this as a battery box? What if this fits into my car? What if this table is big enough for a field day? What if? That same what-if attitude will stand you in good stead when you experiment with antennas. Don't be afraid of failing. The more you fail, the better you learn. What if isn't scary. It's inbuilt into this hobby of amateur radio. I'm Onno, Victor Kilo 6, Foxtrot Lima Alpha Bravo.
Daily Minutes zijn dagelijks vanaf ongeveer 1900 uur te beluisteren. De uitzending wordt een dag later om 10:30 ochtends herhaald. Alle mail is welkom op het adres x@xdv.me. Dat is ook te vinden rechts bovenaan de webpagina van de uitzendingen www.pa0ete.nl. De Daily Minutes toont iedere dag weer aan de hand van schokkende voorbeelden hoe een hobby mensenlevens kan veranderen. De internetfaciliteiten en studiohardware voor Daily Minutes worden gesponsord door 70MHzShop.nl. 70MHzShop.nl.
En microfoon naar retour.